The magic pill to getting anything you want in life is getting more energy and then directing that energy to a well-defined goal. But is that you? Most likely you are a part of the 74% of people that report daytime tiredness that affects their productivity. How are you supposed to get that side hustle off the ground if you barely have enough energy to complete the tasks at your day job? In this video, we will use data from these neuroscience devices to test and validate the most common tricks and tips out there for improving your sleep and boosting your energy. I'm Dr. Cody Rall, a US Navy trained physician. I've assembled an all-star team of neuroscientists that work with NASA, Nike, and various other institutions to help me analyze and interpret the data for this video. Warning, the neuroscience findings at the end might shock you.
How long have I been asleep? 13 minutes!
We will learn how one bad habit first thing in the morning can ruin your entire day and create an unnecessary uphill battle for you. We will take a look at the effects of alcohol, screen time, video games, caffeine, and some interesting brand new devices that are hitting the market designed to help you stop feeling tired in the mornings during the day and allow you to avoid pharmaceuticals.
What I have to do to fall asleep is go to sleep. Right? Is that what you're saying, Melissa?
It is something that we are all guilty of. That alarm goes off and you just keep hitting that snooze button to get a little bit more shut eye, but is it doing more harm than good? Our bodies have a natural sleep cycle of around 90 minutes. You probably have seen these graphs of our full night of sleep where we drift in and out of different stages of sleep. There are stages 1 through 4 non-REM sleep and then REM sleep where we dream. Ideally, either you wake up on your own or your alarm goes off when you are at a light stage 1 sleep cycle. There are even websites where you can calculate your ideal wake time based on the time that you went to bed. If you're at a light stage 1 of sleep when your alarm goes off, you can get up really quickly, be alert, feel rested, and ready to tackle the day. But if you hit that snooze button, you can quickly drift back into a deeper stage of sleep within minutes. And then if your alarm goes off 15 minutes later when you are awakened, you're going to be very groggy because you've drifted into a deeper state of sleep. This really can affect your whole day because your circadian rhythm really thrives on routine. To demonstrate this, our brain activity can be tracked through these electroencephalography EEG devices. These days, they're handy, mobile, and can sync to your smartphone. Generally, our brain waves that can be tracked by these devices are in the slow delta and theta waves when we sleep. And then when we awaken, our brains go into higher frequency alpha and beta range. So when we sleep, our brain waves go down into the deeper and slower delta and theta waves. And when we wake up, they come through alpha and up into the beta gamma range. The problem is that you can mess up that transition into the faster frequencies if you hit that snooze button and get stuck in the alpha range for the day. Now to demonstrate this, I use the EEG devices. I use both the Muse headband and the Neurosity headset, and I put on the devices right after I woke up in the morning and then hit the snooze button and recorded what happened to my brainwaves as I drifted back off to sleep after I hit the snooze. Then I sent off the data to my neuroscientist friends, Dr. Scott Burwell from University of Minnesota and Dr. Olav Krigolsen from the University of Victoria to analyze the brainwaves and let me know what they found.
So hitting the snooze button, going back to bed, tends to put you back into those slower waves of sleep.
You can see on the bottom half, if you look around where the 10 is, the 10 hertz, you see this massive spike of activity. And this kind of makes sense. You expect more alpha when you're relaxed. So as you were lying there in bed, your brain is pretty chill and pretty relaxed as you're waking up, and it's you know, heading in the direction of falling back asleep.
And of course, I had to talk to my wife about my sleep habits, because who else would know better than what my sleep habits look like from the outside? Don't you feel more groggy when you hit the snooze like multiple times?
I do, yeah, and I've noticed that when I do that, I have to take a nap in the afternoon.
Here are some quick tips to avoid hitting the snooze button in the morning. Try your best to get up on the first alarm. This will really put you ahead and start your day off right. If you tend to hit your alarm and go back to sleep to snooze, try putting your alarm or your phone somewhere across the room so that you actually have to get up and turn the alarm off so that you don't have that habit of hitting the snooze button. Once you're up and out of bed, it will be easier to continue with your day. One thing that I like to do is reduce all barriers. Put out your clothes the night before so that you don't have to make any decisions in the early morning and make it really easy to get going. I like to go to the gym first thing in the morning, so I will have my gym bag packed the night before so it's very quick to get up and moving and wake up quickly and get my day started right.
You have a very good sleeping routine.
You go to... Oh, you mean like lay down at 8 p.m.?
Yeah. I think it's just like good habits that you have. So getting things ready the night before just allows you less time to like scramble around trying to find things to wear. Yeah. And
all these little things will significantly improve your ability to get up on the first alarm in the morning and really get started off on the right step. Now we know this is all easier said than done, but getting up on time will actually be highly dependent on what you did the night before. Remember those sleep cycles that we talked about? Well, there's a lot of things that can disrupt those sleep cycles, and one of the biggest perpetrators in the modern day is alcohol. Alcohol completely disrupts the sleep pattern and makes it so that even if you got 8 hours of sleep, you'll still be tired the next day because you didn't go through the proper sleep cycles. The problem with alcohol is that it suppresses REM sleep, meaning that even if you get a full 8 hours under the effect of alcohol, you are not gonna feel 100% the next day simply because you didn't get any REM sleep. To test this, I did about 6 shots of my favorite bourbon, recorded my intoxicated brainwaves, and sent the data off to the team for analysis.
Alcohol, as it accumulates in your brain, can lead to a lesser excitability or a slowing of your brainwaves. When you drink a lot, it tends to push you into this deep sleep state. Early in the night lead to initial slow wave sleep. The problem is that your brain has a hard time rebounding back into REM sleep.
And what you're left off with is a massive increase in delta power when you're intoxicated. If you've gone to bed and you've had a couple drinks, you sort of go down to stage 3 and stage 4 and you stay there. So you get down into this slow wave sleep and you don't come out of it really. That means you don't dream as much because you're not going up to dream sleep, which has far less slow waves, so the REM sleep. And it also has impacts, interestingly enough, on learning and memory.
Then with the hangover, you have dehydration, you have rebound anxiety from certain neurotransmitters, and you also have a rebound effect of REM sleep the next night, which can also affect your sleep and make you feel tired 2 days after you drank.
Damn it, no!
Generally, you would want to avoid alcohol entirely, especially if you have a history of depression or anxiety. But if you're generally healthy, one strategy that might help is to stay very hydrated, limit your amount of alcohol intake, and try to drink earlier in the evenings so that it wears off and doesn't disrupt your sleep too much when you actually do go to bed. Now, it's all well and good to avoid alcohol, but what if you naturally have trouble going to sleep, like 50% of adults that experience insomnia in their lifetime? One thing to really watch out for in the evening hours is screen time. Although the World Wide Web and our mobile devices have opened up information to the masses, our brains have certainly been affected by the way that we consume it. Our electronic device screens emit blue light that can increase the amount of beta and gamma brainwave frequencies and make it more difficult to go to sleep right before bed. It also simulates daylight, which can decrease melatonin production, the hormone that signals when it's time to go to sleep. All of these factors will make it more difficult to go to sleep if you have been scrolling through your phone or looking at screens before bed. I think the biggest example of this is video games. Not only are you being exposed to the blue light, but the exciting and leveling up nature of the video games releases a ton of dopamine and also gets those high frequency brainwaves firing like almost nothing else. It really can make it difficult to get a good night's rest after an evening of gaming.
Yeah. Conversation, but what happens when I'm playing video games?
You just are focused on the video game, and I could be asking you a question or talking to you, and you would just not be like responsive, which gets annoying. Yeah.
Let's see what the neuroscientists had to say about the brainwaves recorded during video game play.
So remember, you sent me some EEGs that you had recorded at different states of consciousness when you were waking in the afternoon playing video games, etc. This amount of excitability increases. Playing video games, the excitability might increase even more.
And in fact, at the end of the scale on normal brain activity, you can't even see the bars, they're so small, but you get a little hint of them when you're playing video games. What you're doing is you're activating your brain. So at a time when your brain and your natural circadian rhythms are trying to slow things down and get you ready for sleep and you're trying to release melatonin, you're actually doing the opposite. You're literally firing it up and saying, hey, you know, let's be engaged.
And then what I noticed too is like when I'm playing and I'm really into it,
like I physically get jittery.
Mm-hmm.
Like that dopamine effect is like a drug almost. Present. Like, yeah, like I can feel it in my body. So although I wouldn't say give up video games completely, just be aware that it's probably having more of an effect on your brain than you realize, especially in the evening hours where you're actually interfering with the natural cycles that are trying to prepare you for sleep. A better practice is settling down and reading a nice book for an hour before bed. Your brain and energy levels the next day will thank you. Let's cover a few more quick tips to help you be ready for sleep at night. Make sure to get a dose of morning sunlight just after you get up and the sun comes up to set your circadian rhythm from the get-go so your body knows when it's time to sleep 16 or so hours later. Get some exercise during the day to burn off extra energy. Make sure that your bedroom is cool and dark at night and try not to get too stressed or wound up during the day. And then there's the sneaky sleep killer, caffeine. In his book, Why We Sleep, Dr. Matthew Walker talks about the cycles of adenosine and melatonin with our sleep and wake cycle. Adenosine increases during the day to signal when it's time to go to sleep and builds up with sleep deprivation. Sleep is the only thing that we know that clears adenosine levels, but caffeine blocks the effects of adenosine to help us stay awake. The problem is that caffeine stays in your body much longer than most people think. The half-life of caffeine can be over 6 hours, meaning that if you have a coffee or a soda at 2 p.m., half of that caffeine is still in your body by 8 p.m. when you're trying to wind down for sleep. That can make it very difficult to actually go to sleep, so make sure to limit your caffeine intake after noon. I've really enjoyed some of these alternative methods that are coming out. Generally, I do a 10-minute neurofeedback session first thing in the morning with my Mendy neurofeedback device to wake up my frontal lobe so that I can concentrate first thing in the morning. I've also tried some transdermal stimulation patches from Filzing that really wake you up in the afternoon to avoid caffeine. There's also the Muse S that can help you do some meditation and wind down for sleep in the evening hours. And if you're really having trouble, there's this magnetic stimulation device called NeuroRhythm that can actually slow down your brainwave and help you get to sleep. In fact, NeuroRhythm just came out with a pillow that you can try that is even more comfortable to use before bed than the headband. In conclusion, the fundamentals of having a set sleep schedule, avoiding alcohol, too much caffeine, and trying your best not to snooze in the morning are your bedrock. The devices certainly can supplement that routine and make you much less tired during the day.
If you are getting your 7 to 9 hours of sleep at night and you're waking up and you're feeling refreshed, these spikes are lower and that is directly tied to your ability to leap out of bed and get going.
If you want to do a deeper dive on the brain devices, I did do a comprehensive video right here. I think you'll enjoy it a lot. But that's it for now. I'm Dr. Cody Rall with Techforpsych. Thanks so much for watching. Be sure to subscribe and I'll see you next time.